السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. We begin by mentioning the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send His peace and His blessings upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Peace be upon him. Brothers and sisters, in the previous session, we spoke how in the 8th year after immigration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to conquer the city of Mecca after the people of Quraysh and their other tribes that joined them in the treaty. If you remember, when they breached the covenant, when they were treacherous, as a result, the Prophet ﷺ came to Mecca and conquered it. Now, while the Prophet ﷺ was in Mecca, there were two tribes not too far from Mecca, Hawazin and Thaqif. They were so angry and upset at how Muhammad ﷺ, this man, according to them, who 8 years ago, you ran for your life from Mecca and now you take over the city of Mecca, the religious capital of Arabia. The aspect of jealousy or the aspect of arrogance and the aspect of so much pride, أخذتهم العزة بالإثم. Their pride pushed them to be hostile and vicious and they did not accept that. And that's a lesson we all have to learn from. Many times in life you might have people, your colleagues or so, who started, let's say you start in a job, at a level higher than your friends and your family, but then they end up growing beyond your level. Instead of trying to pull them down, why don't you and I try to go up, Allahu Akbar, and actually encourage them and pray for them. And whenever you pray for your brother and sister, the angels pray for you and the dua comes back to you. So they, brothers and sisters, did not accept of that. And this is the epitome of arrogance. When is arrogance the epitome of it? Is when Allah is saying something. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says something and we reject it. After we know it's an authentic narration, that's what it actually means, then we reject it. May Allah protect us from that. And by the way, arrogance and pushing the truth is not just to religious matters. It can be something as simple as the following. Someone is driving. They miss an exit in the highway. The spouse tells them, oh, you missed the exit. And the person recognizes, yes, I did miss the exit. But they say, oh, no, no, I know what I'm doing. Don't worry about it. I got it. Actually, there's another exit that leads to a better, you know, path. No, you acknowledged your mistake. You acknowledged your shortcoming. Don't be arrogant and push back the truth after you recognized it. May Allah keep us humble and accept the truth whenever it comes to us, whether it comes from a young person, an adult, Muslim, non-Muslim, male and female, so long as the truth has come. May Allah allow you and I to accept it. Ameen. So with this being said, the leader from Hawazin started to prepare the army, gathered so much so that you might be shocked about this. They gathered the army so much so that they told the soldiers, bring your women with you, your mom, your wife, your children. What? Mom, wife, sister, the children, yes, bring them with you. And bring all of your wealth. If all what I need is one camel, and I have seven at home, I'm a wealthy man, I have 7, 10. Why in the world would I have to bring the 7 and the 10? And that leader was asked, why are you commanding us to bring our women, our children, and our wealth? He said, لِكَيْ يُقَاتِلُ دُونَهُمْ. So they can all fight and protect them and they will never run away. So if the Muslims, they come and somehow they beat us and we're dying one after the other, you will not run away. You will fight and protect your wife and you protect your children and your wealth. So one of the elders came to this leader from the enemy from Hawazin. He told them, what are you doing? He told them, if we lose the battle, we lost everything. And when the battle becomes basically serious, nobody's going to care about who's around them. They're going to run for their lives. But this man, he insisted. And subhanAllah, once again, wisdom is being brought to you from the elders. Experience, he still rejected that. May Allah grant us humbleness and accept lessons that we know, inshallah, are true and clear to us. May Allah allow us to follow the footsteps of the righteous. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. But he insisted, and his word is what went through. And the soldiers came with their women, children, and all of their wealth. And there was so much money. You're talking about 24,000 camels. Today's time, I'm giving you just a rough estimate. We're talking about $20 million or so of today's time. Not just that, 40,000 goats in addition to whatever other cattle they brought with them. And they start heading towards a valley known as Hunain. The valley of what? Hunain. It was approximately 10 miles away from Mecca. And they went there early before the Prophet ﷺ came. When the news came to the Prophet ﷺ, there are two tribes and others tried to join. to fight you, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also took his preparations. Did we remember to say sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Don't forget, may Allah bless you and grant you Jannah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent a scout, and that's something we learn from him. Don't like, oh, people are saying that, okay, let's react. No, confirm the news. So then he sent someone, a scout, which he trusts, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He went, got the news, Ya Rasulullah, it's true, they're gathered, they're very close to us, and they want to fight us. With that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gathered the army. But here's the thing. Remember in the previous session, how much were the Muslims in terms of the army? 10,000 soldiers, excellent. This moment, they are 12,000. How is it 12,000 when they spent approximately 19 days? Many of the people of Mecca, Quraysh, when they saw the Prophet ﷺ coming and the forgiveness he gave to much of them, many of them accepted Islam, actually over than 2,000, and 2,000 of them joined the 10,000 and they became 12,000. Allahu Akbar. As beautiful as the number may sound, brothers and sisters, there were some of the companions who were new to Islam, all right? And their faith is not as strong as others. And some of the younger companions, they belittled the battle. La ilaha illallah. But why? Check this out. They said, today we are the largest army the Muslims have ever gathered. And that's true. This is the largest Muslim army ever gathered. So they said, we will never lose with such large number of people. Like, our loss will never be due to numbers. Who heard that? The Prophet ﷺ. He disapproved of such sentence. He disapproved of such conclusion. Because this seems that you guys are relying on Allah. No, it seems that you are relying on your numbers. You're relying on your wealth. You're relying on your capabilities. No. What's the successful equation? You take the means plus rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then the victory comes. Otherwise, it's failure, brothers and sisters. And what do I mean with success? Success in this life is peace in the heart. May Allah grant it to you. Tranquility in the heart and peace in one's life and serenity. May Allah grant it to you and your loved ones. That will only come when we are connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the good life Allah promises the believers. And in the afterlife, Allahu Akbar, success is Jannah. May Allah grant you to be there. And may Allah allow me to see you all, my dear beloved brothers and sisters. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. So with that being said, the Prophet ﷺ, he heard that. He disapproved of this. And some of the younger companions, they did not take the battle very serious. They were not well equipped. They didn't take much armor with them or body armor. May Allah protect us and grant us wisdom. And they proceeded towards the valley of Hunayn. That was approximately after 19 days of being in Mecca. On their way there, something very interesting happened. Ready for this? The Prophet ﷺ, as he was leading the army, they passed by a tree. That tree was known as Dhatu Anwat. A tree of a lot of branches. Okay, what's so special that you're telling us about the tree? This tree, the polytheists, the pagans, those who don't worship Allah, they used to seek blessings from the tree. So they used to hang their swords on it, getting blessings. Maybe they'll fight better next day or so. You know, they used to sacrifice their cattle for the tree, getting blessings from it. So much of the new Muslims in the Muslim army with the Prophet ﷺ, they said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, اجعل لنا ذات أنوات. Make for us a tree with branches, just like how the pagans have it, so we can have one basically we can benefit from, and so on and so forth. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Subhanallah, Allah is free from any need. Allah is free from any partners. And in another narration, he said, Wallahu Akbar, and Allah is greater than everything and anything. Then he said, what you guys are asking for is very similar. Pay attention, very similar to what children of Israel asked Prophet Moses back in the day. Very similar request. And the Prophet ﷺ, he quotes the two verses which Musa, his role model, told the companions of his. Look what he said. إِنَّكُمْ قَوْمٌ تَجْهَلُونَ. What you said is ignorance. What you said is that's misinformation. So watch what you ask for. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he quoted the other verse in which he says, "Inna ha'ulai mutabbarum ma hum fi." That these people who follow these things are in a miserable state. Don't think there's actually blessings from this tree. Then he says, "Wabatilum ma kanu ya'malun." And all the time they're spending, all the money they're spending is all gone to waste. This does not benefit. Did you pay attention to something? Did the Prophet ﷺ tell anyone, all of you have disbelieved? All of you became kuffar? Did he say that? Did he say, I want everybody who said the tree to get the blessings from it, everybody follow me and say, Ashhadu an la ilaha. No, he did not throw that label at them. Oh, you all became kuffar. And you have to be very watchful. These people said it out of ignorance. قَوْمٌ تَجْهَلُونَ. You're ignorant about this situation. With that being said, brothers and sisters, I warn you with absolute, yani, stressing on this point, avoid throwing the label on your brothers and sisters. She's a kafira. He's a kafir. You see what he said about this hadith? You said, I always said, what? Relax. And sometimes we're excited. Yes, they have committed kufr. You should be in pain when someone says a statement of disbelief. And you have to be watchful and understand, why did they say that? And after explaining to them, a brother, I already explained to them and they don't seem like they want to apply what I said. So as a result, okay, relax. You explained it to them. Great job. But did they understand? Did they understand? SubhanAllah, don't rush. As our teachers, they tell us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not ask you, why did you not tell your brother he's a kafir or your sister she's a kafira? No, rather Allah will ask you, why did you label them that they're kuffar and so on and so forth? Listen to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's authentic narration. He says, أَيُّمَا رَجُلٍ, any man or woman, قَالَ لِأَخِيهِ, and tells their brother or sister, ready for this? Whoever tells their brother or sister, يَا كَافِرْ, oh you kafir disbeliever, فَقَدْ بَاءَ بِهَا أَحَدُهُمَا, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, then one of you is a kafir. What does that mean? If you mislabeled your brother and sister and you said ya kafir or ya kafir to the sister and you were wrong, then it goes back to you and you become the kafir. La ilaha illallah. Is it worth it? When it's absolutely necessary that you have to throw the label and you're fully aware and educated that what they're doing and what they're saying is something that warns them that they're outside the fold of Islam, khalas, they left it, and not saying it out of ignorance, not saying it out of fear or there's a gun pointed at them. May Allah make us not hasty, and may Allah make you and I a source of wisdom. I had to stress on this point. The Prophet ﷺ, after that discussion, he advised them, this has no benefit. Allah does not need no partner or some sort of association. And all the money and the time that we spend putting sword, that's all waste of time and money. May Allah protect us and forgive us. So next time, maybe your father, your mother does something like that, take it easy on them. Wallahi, we know people have committed, they said that my parent became kuffar. Why? Because they tossed, check this out, they tossed a quarter, 25 cents, into a pond of water and they made a wish. And that's it, you're a kafir. You know what it means when you say that? You strip that individual from all the rights of the Muslim. That all the rights a Muslim has over the other is gone because of that statement. May Allah protect us. May Allah forgive us. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. So let's proceed. Headed towards what? The Valley of Hunayn. Excellent. Now, as they're getting there, they arrived late at night. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ يَحْرُسُنَا اللَّيْلَى. Who will be the one who will protect us? Who will be the one who is going to serve as a security guard? And one of the Sahaba, his name is Anas ibn Abi Marthadin al-Ghanawi. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I will volunteer to be the security guard. And the main job is what? Anybody he notices coming to the camp at night, you call us, you let us know, wake up the camp, but you want you to be very vigilant and let us know basically ahead of time as they're coming towards us. So the night has passed, all the way till dawn, and this wonderful man, Anas radiallahu anh, kept his eyes wide open all night till the morning. And all what he took breaks were for two reasons, short breaks. Number one, to use the bathroom, and number two, to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After the task has been accomplished, in the next morning, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw Anas and he told him he will be earning Jannah. Allahu Akbar. Over the few hours he stayed up night watching over the believers, yes, you are going to earn Jannah. While his heart is still beating. You want that reward? You want it? Check this hadith out. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عينان, two eyes. لا تمسهما النار. Two eyes that will never be touched by the hellfire. May Allah protect you and your loved ones. So this means that individual, two types of people, and this hadith will not go to hellfire. Who are they? So you and I can do our best to be among them. Number one, عَيْنٌ بَكَتْ مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. An eye that cried out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of the conscience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Someone remembered their sins and their shortcomings and they're like, Ya Allah, forgive me. And the tears basically start flowing on their cheeks. May Allah grant you that reward. That person will not go to Jahannam, inshallah. But what's the other eye? What Anas radiallahu anhu did. And an eye that stayed up, protecting and standing on guard in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward us. So be watchful. If your eyes are up late at night especially, that your eyes are watching that which is halal, that your eyes are doing something that you go to Allah and you're proud of. And if your eyes or my eyes were looking at something that Allah will not be happy about, then may Allah make us ask for His forgiveness. And may Allah forgive us. And may Allah make our eyes cry out of hoping for Allah's forgiveness. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. And then the Prophet ﷺ, after giving the good news, now in the early morning, the day of the battle, Bismillah, they're headed towards the battle. But I want to tell you something the Prophet ﷺ and the believers do not know. What is it? The two tribes, Hawaz and Thaqif, and the enemy has plotted a trap. What's a trap? I want you to visualize the following with me. Ready? Two mountains. It's a valley between two mountains. It's steep. So the Muslims will come, let's say, from this direction and going downwards. And the enemy will be in the opposite side. But the thing is, not the entire army of the enemy is in the front. Where's the rest? Hiding on the sides of the valley, behind rocks, the narrow passes between the mountains. They're hiding. And what's the plan? When the Muslims, they come closer, 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 they pop up from both sides and shake them. And a huge shock against them and start throwing arrows towards the enemy, causing panic and chaos. And they're optimistic that they will defeat the Prophet ﷺ and the believers. So let's go back to the Muslim army. Yes, they're here. They're coming down. In Hidar, it's steep. They're going down. And now they see the enemy at the front. The ones on the sides have not popped up yet. As you're coming closer, they saw the enemy. Remember the younger companions? The ones that were not very well equipped, they were so hasty and they rushed towards the enemy to go and fight them and so on and so forth. And they came so close. Some of the companions went as far, just from the first beginning of the battle, as collecting the cattle. They saw all these camels, all of these goats. This is unbelievable. So they kind of, perhaps Allah knows us, fell for it. And they went to collect the war gains. And right then and there, bam, from the both sides, the enemy has popped up. People was like, what's going on? And the arrows were being shot towards them. And some of the believers perhaps got shot. And brothers and sisters at this point, some even narrated the Khalid bin Walid, radiallahu anhu. He got shot by one of the arrows. And there was panic. And the first ones to retreat were those younger companions that did not take it very serious. And when they retreated back uphill, it was chaotic. Bumping body to body, camel to camel, horse to horse, running back up. And imagine the dust and the chaos. So much so that one after the other was going back, one after the other, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was shocked. He says, Ya ayyuhan nas, O people, ayna ayyuhan nas, where in the world are you going, O people, where are you going? And no one is responding. He says, Ana Rasulullah, I am the messenger of Allah. Basically, I'm still here. Ana Rasulullah, I'm the messenger of Allah. No one is looking back. He says, Ana Muhammad ibn Abdullah, I am Muhammad, the son of Abdullah. No one is looking back. Everyone is fleeing. And here, brothers and sisters, to appreciate this scene, listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about it.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. لقد نصركم الله في مواطن كثيرة ويوم حنين إذ أعجبتكم كثرتكم ويوم حنين إذ أعجبتكم كثرتكم فلم تغن عنكم شيئا وضاقت عليكم الأرض بما رحبت ثم وليتم مدبرين.
الله أكبر. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appreciate this? How Allah says, I have given you victories in many battles and even on the day of Hunayn. And when you were so proud, إذ أعجبتكم, you were so proud of your numbers, huh? My numbers are so big. We will never be defeated due to numbers. We got everything. This is the largest army ever the Muslims have ever assembled. What did Allah say? فَلَمْ تُغْنِي عَنْكُمْ شَيْئًا. Your numbers didn't benefit you. Your weapons didn't benefit you. Your body armors didn't benefit you. Your strength didn't benefit you. Nothing benefited you. And wallahi, that's true. Nothing will benefit you. Nothing will benefit me. No one will benefit you and I except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and believe in Allah, that is when the true benefit, the most important type of benefit, Allah's help and assistance, Allah's serenity that He gives to our hearts, that's the greatest benefit. Allahu Akbar. Brothers and sisters, and we start to retreat. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and the earth became so tight after it was vast. ثُمَّ وَلَّيْتُمْ مُدْبِرِينَ Then you all retreated back. May Allah forgive us and protect us. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. Brothers and sisters, how big was the army? 12,000 soldiers. How many of the 12,000 remained in the battle? What's your guess? 10. 10. No, no, not 10,000. 10 out of 12,000 soldiers approximately. And who were they? Without the need of me telling you, for sure, without a doubt, the most courageous of out of all of them, the bravest of all of them, Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, was one of the 10. And who else? Grand companions. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Umar ibn al-Khattab, and who else from the Sahaba? Wa Ayman ibn Ubaid, wa Usama ibn Zayd. Great companions. And then 5 members from one family. Allahu Akbar, what family is this? What an honor. Ay wallah. This is a family that we love them for the sake of Allah. This is a family that we seek the closeness of Allah towards loving them. We pray for them every single day. This is Ahlul Bayt, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. 5 members, Ali ibn Abi Talib, his uncle Al-Abbas, the son of Al-Abbas Al-Fadl, and who else? Wa Abu Sufyan ibn Al-Harith and Wa Rabi'at ibn Al-Harith. May Allah subhanahu Allahumma salli wa sallim ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi and his family. Ameen rabbal alamin wa sallim. Brothers and sisters, and Rasulullah is looking at this scene and he makes dua to Allah. He knows victory is in the hands of Allah. Thumma nazala wastansar. He came down from his mule and he made dua to Allah. He said, Allahumma nazil nasarak. Allahumma nazil nasarak. Oh Allah, send us your victory. Ya Allah, send us your victory. Right then and there, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on his mule headed towards the enemy. Really? He headed towards the enemy. And he kept saying, أَنَا النَّبِيُّ لَكَذِبْ أَنَا ابْنُ عَبْدِ الْمُطَّلِبِ Allahu Akbar, you feel it? He says, I am a prophet, no lie. I am the grandson of Abd al-Muttalib. I am a prophet, no lie. And he's headed towards the enemy. Al-Abbas, his uncle, and his cousin, Abu Sufyan ibn al-Harith, he tried to hold down the mule, fearing for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells Al-Abbas, Ya Abbas, call out who? The group of people that gave a pledge of allegiance under a tree called As-Samura. There's a tree called As-Samura. 2 years ago, there were about 1,400 companions under that tree that gave the pledge to fight till death. And we mentioned it in Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, the Hudaybiyah Treaty. So the Prophet says, Ya Abbas, call these people. So Al-Abbas says, Aina ashabu as-Samura? And Al-Abbas, may Allah be pleased by him, he was known to have a very loud voice. Allahu Akbar. Aina ashabu as-Samura? Where are the people that of that tree? Those who gave the pledge. That was the title of those who participated. Then they all looked back. They came to their senses. Rasulullah is still there. Then they said, ya labbaik, Rasulullah. Here we are at your service. And they start coming so fast back to the army. Allahu Akbar. One after the other. See, they learned their lesson. Everybody learned their lesson. They didn't say only 10 Muslims, what's the point of me coming back? No, because it was never about numbers. So they trusted Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're taking the means, joining the Prophet sallam. And the narration says, Al-Abbas says, and they were coming back the way a mother runs to go protect her child. That's how the companions felt towards the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, running back. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells Al-Abbas, Ya Abbas, call the muhajirin, the immigrants, those who left Mecca back in the day. They sacrificed their wealth, they sacrificed even their assets from the homes just to go join the Prophet. Call these people. So Al-Abbas calls them, the muhajirin. And they all came back, Ya Labbaik, we're coming as fast as possible. You know how fast? The narration says that if the camel was not going as fast as they wanted, they would jump off the camel and then run and sprint to the Prophet ﷺ. Allahu Akbar. I want you to appreciate this. The camel is like a car. It's like there's a lot of traffic. I have to go to a very important meeting that I leave my car with the keys on and I just leave the highway. What if someone steals it? It doesn't matter. That person I'm meeting is more important and more valuable. Allahu Akbar. And I could not wait a single second. And that's what the companions did. Came back to their senses. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Al-Abbas, call the Ansar. And he called Al-Ansar, the supporters, the ones who were in Medina, and they hosted the refugees or the immigrants that came from Mecca. Allahu Akbar. So they called and he also came, Ya Labbaik, Ya Labbaik. And that was the grandest of the Sahaba coming back. And here the tables have turned, and now the Muslims are getting stronger and stronger and stronger. They fought so much, brothers and sisters. The fight was so vicious, so strong. Al-Abbas was looking at it, he says, it was very even. As we were fighting, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, don't forget, say sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he looked up and stretched his neck to see the battlefield. Then he says, هَذَا حِينَ حَمِيَ الْوَطِيسِ. Now we're talking. This is the real deal. This is the battle. Now this is the real deal. This is the effort that we want to put. Put everything we can and trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, with that being said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he grabbed some pebbles from the ground, looked at the enemy and threw it at the enemy. What's the point of that? He took the means, took the effort. Allah sends His soldiers. Allah sends His miracles. Grabbed the pebbles and he threw it towards the enemy. Al-Abbas says, not a single soldier of the enemy except that dust entered their eyes. Could no longer see. Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this beautiful verse.
ثم أنزل الله سكينته على رسوله وعلى المؤمنين وأنزل جنودا لم تروها وعذب الذين كفروا وذلك جزاء الكافرين ثم يتوب الله من بعد ذلك على من يشاء والله غفور رحيم.
Brothers and sisters, have you heard what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said? Allah sent down His peace and tranquility, and wallahi, that's what will happen to every one of us. When we do our obligations, when we do our best to stay away from prohibitions, and when we repent, when we ever fall, that Allah sends the peace to the heart. May Allah send it to all of us. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. And right then and there, when they relied on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they have put the effort, Allah says that I have sent down, in addition to the peace and tranquility, soldiers which you cannot see. Some of the scholars, they said they were the angels that Allah sent to fight. And as a result, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we have defeated basically the disbelievers. And that is the payback of those who disbelieved at that time. Brothers and sisters, and alhamdulillah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the believers were victorious, so much so that the enemy started to flee away. They started to go back from where they came from, to go back to other parts in Arabia. They fled away. Brothers and sisters, did they take away with them the cattle? They did not. As the elder that advised the man, if we lose everything. And once their lives were in danger, they left things behind and they ran away for their life. Brothers and sisters, with the war gains that were left and the Muslims were victorious, and alhamdulillah, I pray to Allah that both of us, me and you, have learned a lesson, major lesson from this. Trust Allah. Put the effort, and I know I repeated this, but wallahi, this is the formula of success in this life and the afterlife. May Allah allow you and I to accomplish it. Ameen. The war gains, 24,000 camels, 40,000 goats, and much, much more. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam start to give right and left. The people, one guy, he gave him 100 camels, and another 100 camels. Some companions, especially from Quraysh, and especially the new Muslims, they got many of the war gains to help ease the transition for them, to help increase their faith, make things easy on them. May Allah make things easy on all of us, brothers and sisters. So much so when the giving has been taking place and some people still wanted more. Remember that people's faith are at different levels. Some people really were like shoving around. I want more. I want this. I want that. They kept shoving around and elbowing around, so much so that the clothing, the cloak of the Prophet ﷺ got stuck to a tree. So he says, "Atuni ridai, give me back my clothing, give me back my cloak." He said, "Wallahi, if I had the number of cattle as the number of the tree leaves, you see the tree leaves? If I had that much of cattle to pass around, I will give it all and you will not find me stingy. You will not find me a coward and you will not find me a liar." Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And people still, some of them still pushed, and one Bedouin, you know, being a bit, some of them very tough, very, very firm and harsh. May Allah forgive us. And he came and he grabbed the Prophet ﷺ from his shirt, a Muslim. Huh? He's like, yeah, Rasulullah, give me from what Allah has given you. He stretched it so hard. He grabbed the shirt so hard that it left a mark on the neck of the Prophet ﷺ. What some people may do today. This man may not live five more minutes. Basically a sign, get rid of this guy. What are you doing? Especially now Muhammad ﷺ being the leader of much of Arabia, the strongest of all of them. But you know what he did? He smiled. I don't know what to tell you. I have to tell you the narration as is. And may Allah allow you and I to follow the footsteps of the Prophet ﷺ. He smiled and he told the people, give him more, give him more. Alayhi salatu wasalam. As Allah says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Indeed, ya Muhammad, indeed Muhammad, you have the greatest of character. May Allah beautify my character and your character, my dear brother and sister. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. With that being said, did all get everything? Like, did all the companions get war gains? Alhamdulillah, no. There's a group of people that did not get anything, brothers and sisters. Who are these people? The Ansar, the supporters, the ones, the original residents of Medina. They participated in the battle, but the Prophet ﷺ chose not to give them anything. And how did they feel? They got a little bit hurt. Really? Yes. They even said to one another, may Allah forgive the Prophet. He gave his people, he gave Quraysh, but he left us alone, even though blood is still dripping from our swords. They said, لَقِيَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَهْلَهُ. Basically, the Prophet ﷺ has now reunited with his family, you know, those from Mecca and so on. Subhanallah. The Creator is the Creator, and the creation is the creation. No one is perfect. No one is perfect. So the leader of the Ansar, Sa'd ibn Ubadah, he heard that concern from his followers, or the ones whom he leads from the Ansar, and he went to the Prophet ﷺ. He said, Ya Rasulullah, the Ansar, the supporters, they are hurt because of you. So the Prophet said, Fima, why are they hurt? Sa'd ibn Ubadah, may Allah be pleased by him, he said, because the way you distributed the war gains, you gave everybody, you gave your tribe, you gave the other Arab, but you did not give them anything to the Ansar. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked Sa'd, and how do you feel? So Sa'd said, I am not but a member of my tribe, meaning I also feel the same way. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells Sa'd ibn Ubadah, call all of the Ansar into this area, this yard, and once they're all collected and they're seated or they're there, let me know. So the Prophet basically wants to talk to them. So Sa'd ibn Ubadah listened, and he start calling the Ansar, come here, go to this yard, and they start being gathered. And before we continue, you have to appreciate something. How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a type of leader that was showing the people, I am willing to hear criticism. I'm willing to hear your feelings. I'm willing to have the open door policy. And we learn something very profound here. If there is someone that hurts you, someone that is beloved to you, especially if someone that you will deal with on a daily basis or see very often, and even if you saw them once in a lifetime, if they hurt you, you address that with them. You say, you know what, the thing that you did here and there really kind of hurt me. And you know what, give them a chance to explain themselves. Maybe they said, oh, I didn't mean it. And wallahi, I went through that one day. I was speaking to someone I really looked up to so much. And I pray for that individual and I learned a lot from him. And then I was talking to him and he did something that kind of interrupted me in a way that appeared very like rude and just walked away. And I was like so confused. I'm like, what just happened? There's more details to it about, then I got hurt. Wallahi, I got so hurt. Then I said, I'm like, what just happened? And I realized what I should do, because he's my brother, because he's my teacher, because he's my sheikh, I will go and address that with him. If the Sa'd ibn Ubadah radiallahu anhu went to the Prophet of Allah alayhi salam, then I can go to my brother and sister inshallah. So I went and I spoke to the sheikh. I said, sheikh, I did this that, such and such happened, and I saw you reacted in that way. It kind of came out, you know, it really hurt me. So then he said, oh, I didn't mean to. Something very urgent came about, and this and such and such. So then, subhanAllah, wallahi, Allah is my witness. After this, I felt so comfortable. Alhamdulillah, was able to kind of, you know, strengthen that bond once again and not make it weak and let the shaitan try to utilize and bank on it. And yeah, he thinks he's better than you. And shaitan says, oh, you're such and such. La, a'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim. And the bonds were mended, walhamdulillah. So that's what the Prophet ﷺ, he said, gather everybody. And Sa'd ibn Ubadah gathered everybody from the Ansar. Excellent. So then Sa'd ibn Ubadah went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, "Ya Rasul," he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, "Ya Rasulullah, the team have gathered." So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to address the gathering of the Ansar. He began by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he said, "Ya ma'ashar al-Ansar, O Ansar, when I first came to you," you know, about 8 years ago, basically, when the Prophet first came to Medina, he said, "Were you not misguided, then Allah guided you? Were you not poor, then Allah provided for you? Were you not enemies to one another, then Allah reunited you?" So they all said, "Bala, bala." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is making the companions remember the blessings that came upon them. And that's one of the key ways, wallahi, scientifically proven. I was reading a research matter about this, how one of the best ways to lift up your spirit when you're down is to think of the blessings you received. Allahu Akbar. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them about these blessings. So they all admitted, "Bala ya Rasulullah, yes, yes, yes." And they kept repeatedly telling the Prophet, "We appreciate you, we appreciate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the companions, "Why do you not answer me? Why do you basically not tell me something similar of what I just told you?" They said, "Al-mannu lillahi wa rasulih," all appreciation is to Allah and you, O Prophet of Allah. You know, we cannot say something like, what can we say? What should we say? No, we're good, ya Rasulullah. He said, "No, you can say stuff just like how I told you, and what you say would have been the truth and would be believed. O Ansar, you could have told the Prophet sallam, 'Laqad ji'tana, O Muhammad, you came to us, taridan fa'awaynak, you were running away for your life and we gave you shelter. You were poor and we gave you aid. You were someone who was rejected and denied and we gave you victory. You were scared and worried and we gave you safety.' You could have said all of that back to me." They said, "Al-mannu lillahi wa rasulih," all appreciations to Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explains how he distributed the war gains. He said, "Are you really hurt over lu'a'a, tiny little bit of this temporary worldly life? 100 camels is a tiny thing, about $1 million or so. Yes, compared to the reward of the akhirah, compared to the real blessing in this life. What blessing in this life is greater than 100 camels and $1 million? It's the blessing of Islam." So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, "You're hurt over me giving them, some of those who just accepted Islam, to ease the transition for them, to help increase their faith and strengthen it. Where I hope that you guys would rely on your faith, you Ansar would to rely on your faith. Your faith is up there." And the Prophet complimented the faith of the Ansar. "And I'm just trying to help the people who just accepted Islam to increase their faith." Subhanallah. And that's the real deal. That's the biggest blessing. May Allah make your last words, brother and sister, and my last words, "La ilaha illallah." That is the greatest blessing. Take all the blessings away. May Allah protect us. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. But that's an example. If someone cannot hear, if someone cannot see, if someone has difficulty and pain, wallahi, the greatest blessing to ease that, And may Allah ease all the pain that our brothers and sisters go through, is to remember that at least, alhamdulillah, we're Muslim. The greatest blessing of all time. Wallahi, what's the point of having all the money in the world that does not even fit in the pockets when the heart is empty? Whereas people have, the hearts are full of faith in Allah and Islam, and know this world is temporary, even if the pockets were not as full. May Allah grant you and I the best of this life and the best of the afterlife. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. So then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "In addition to that, are you not pleased that these people, our brothers and sisters, would go back to their cities?" Because many of the 12,000 are not really from Medina. So eventually after the battle, they'll go back to their homes, whatever city they came from. There's many tribes. So the Prophet ﷺ said, "O Ansar, would you not be pleased that these people, our brothers and sisters, would go back to their cities, go back to their villages with cows, with cattle, with camels and goats, and you go back to Medina with the messenger of God? Would that not be a good way of distribution?" Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "O Ansar, if it was not for my immigration, I would have always been one of you, Ansar." That's how dear the Ansar were to the heart of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Allahumma irham al Ansar." Allahu Akbar, dua from the Prophet of Allah. Dua, supplication from the dearest slave to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Oh Allah, shower your mercy, bless, forgive, grant all goodness to the Ansar." Do you think how they felt? They start to cry. They start to cry until their beards became wet. And the Prophet ﷺ said, "Warham abna al-ansar," and have mercy on the children of the Ansar. "Wa abna al-ansar," and the grandchildren of the Ansar. Then the Ansar were moved by that, by the explanation, by that dua, by comprehending the Prophet is going to come with us sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Medina. They said, "Radina billahi rabba," we are pleased with Allah as our Lord, and with the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam distributed the war gains, we're happy with everything. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left, and the Ansar have left. Alhamdulillah, everything was settled and the bonds strengthened perhaps more than what it was. May Allah allow you and I to be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Brothers and sisters, they realize of the greatest blessings with Islam is to be able to be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Them knowing we will go back with the Prophet, it's more valuable than all the hundreds on the camels, or the thousands of the goats and war gains. The Prophet is with us. And you know, you and I can be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That will be one of the greatest blessings ever in Jannah. But if you truly want to be with the Prophet ﷺ, follow in his footsteps. May Allah make it easy for all of us. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. You want to know who is the closest to the Prophet on the Day of Judgment? Ready for this? The closest of us to be to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as the Prophet taught us, أحاسنكم أخلاقا or أحسنكم خلقا, the one with the best character. May Allah beautify my character and your character. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. Then, brothers and sisters, as the believers, many of them, the Ansar, went back to Medina and everybody went back to their places. Many of the people in Arabia who were not Muslim came from all over Arabia to Medina. Why? To embrace Islam. They saw after the Battle of Hunain, after the conquest of Mecca and other events here and there, in the ninth year after immigration, leaders, individuals came to Medina to testify, there's no one worthy of worship but Allah. And Muhammad, the Prophet of Allah, he is a messenger and a slave of God who says nothing but the truth, who received divine revelation. Brothers and sisters, listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about these moments. Allahu Akbar.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Idha jaa nasrullahi wal fath wa ra'aytan nas yadkhuluna fi dinillahi afwaja. فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا.
So brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us here in these beautiful ayat, when the victory of Allah is coming and the conquest and the people are embracing Islam from all over Arabia, from all over parts of the world, then we should glorify Allah and seek Allah's forgiveness, and Allah accepts our repentance. Allahu Akbar. Brothers and sisters and people start coming from all over asking for questions. Let me share with you one. One of the people that came, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "I want to ask you a question, but I'm very firm and I'm actually harsh and I don't want you to take it personal, okay? Basically, that's my personality." With the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know what he said? He said, "Is'al ma badalak." Ask whatever you want. Allahu Akbar. I will not take it personal. And this man continued to ask questions. The Prophet ﷺ continued to answer. And before that conversation ended, that man accepted Islam. Allahu Akbar. His character was so captivating. His speech was so powerful and motivating that one after the other were coming to the Prophet ﷺ to embrace their Islam. And the Prophet ﷺ told the companions, our brothers and sisters, to know how to prioritize their call to Islam. You gotta watch out from this one. The Prophet ﷺ, for example, he told Mu'adh ibn Jabal, when you go to teach people Islam, make sure you start with the following. Step number one, you teach people about the oneness of Allah. You teach people about La ilaha illallah and that Muhammad is the Prophet of Allah. That's the first thing you start with. And once they accept that, once they obey that, that Allah is the greatest, Allah is the creator, and Muhammad is Allah's slave and messenger, and you use that information and they believe in that and they testify, then you go to point number two, which was praise, five daily prayers. The Prophet said to Mu'adh, go tell them, if they believe in the first one, then Allah has mandated 5 daily prayers upon you. If they obey that and they accept that, then ya Mu'adh, tell them number 3, which is zakah. That there is a certain money given from whom to whom, taken from the rich amongst you and given to the poor amongst you. Allahu Akbar. You see the priority? You see the prioritization in the da'wah and how to call people to Islam? This is not belittling the branches of Islam in any way, shape or form. But this is something to appreciate when we talk to people about Islam and so on. Don't take this personal. But advice, follow the footsteps of the Prophet ﷺ. Wallahi, it can be a waste of time and resources to address other matters in Islam about, you know, such and such when we leave the absolute core of La ilaha illallah. If we spend so much time telling them, for example, the matter of, let's say, the hijab, and we spend so much time on it. Okay, they don't even believe in Allah. They don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you have 5 minutes, please allow me to explain to you Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet alayhi salam. And obviously the matters can be depending on, maybe you have a specific conference and so on and so forth. Allah will, may Allah grant us wisdom, in Rabbil Alameen, but there's something to comprehend. And by the way, this talk about Allah and His Messenger and believing in this core beliefs in Islam is not just a topic to non-Muslims, no, but also to the Muslims. Look what Allah says in the Quran. Allah says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who what? Believe. Fantastic. O you who believe. So they have already are basically believers. Right after that, Allah says, Aminu. Increase your belief. In what? In Allah, His Messenger, and the books. So this is a reminder for all of us that we need these topics about Allah's beautiful names. We need these topics about the Prophet ﷺ's life. Yes, the branches are important, and we're not belittling it, but we need a continuous reminder, as Allah told you and I. Always talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be conscious of Allah. Learn about Allah's power, capability, wisdom, knowledge, the prophethood of Muhammad ﷺ, and the other prophets and the other books. Brothers and sisters, Islam continued to grow all over Arabia. Allahu Akbar. May Allah make your last words and my last words, La ilaha illallah. And in the 10th year after immigration, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verse where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now needs to fulfill one of the 5 pillars of Islam, which is Hajj. He makes the intention to go to Hajj in the 10th year after immigration. Thousands of people want to join the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How was his Hajj like? How did things go? What profound speeches did he give? All of that, inshallah, we will discuss in the next session. May Allah bless you. May Allah protect you. Jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.